Dr. Ashok Chavan, the founder president of MIT Group of Universities and Institutions, and a great visionary and a great dreamer. Dr. T. Sanjesi, the president of IMBAMS 2010, Justice C. K. N. Singh, former Chief Justice of India, Professor Dr. M.S.L. Salgado, eminent expert, Major General K. Jai Singh, Major General R. K. Dhawan, Professor P. K. Chattopadhyaya, Dr. T. D. Dogra, Atul Chavan, the eminent persons on the dais, distinguished delegates from India and abroad, my beloved students of MIT University, most eminent members of the faculty of MIT University, members of the press, friends, this conference is held under the joint auspices of IMPAMS and the MIT University. First of all, I thank you for giving me 20 minutes time to deliver my lecture, which is already over. But still, I seek your indulgence to give me not 20 minutes, 15 minutes, or less than 15 minutes. This is a great event today. We are meeting at the campus of MIT Group of Education, which has three universities and 80,000 students. It's a great dream. And I am told that by 2030, he would like to build it as the biggest educational provider of the world. I wish him all the best. He not only believes in the growth, but he believes in inclusive growth. He believes growth with excellence. You may kindly recall that when Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh appointed me as a chairman of the Oversight Committee at a very turbulent time, particularly more turbulence in our aims, to resolve the conflict, I came out with a slogan, expansion, inclusion and excellence. And it worked today. You may recall that expansion of our institutions of national excellence was 1% for 45 years, which includes AIIMS, which includes ITI, IIT, which includes all the AIIMS and many AIMS, IMS and everything. And today, after we launched the program, we not only resolved the conflict, but we expanded these institutions to 54% within 5 years, from 1% to 54% without sacrificing the quality and level of excellence. I'm more attracted by Dr. Ashok Chavan with this dream of this kind of expansion, inclusion and excellence. This is the real mantra for the future of this great country. You all know that Churchill said, The future empires of the world are built in the human mind. This is what Dr. Ashok Chavan is doing it by building his institutions. I have no doubt that he will achieve his objective. I wish him all the best. Yes, I found a slogan that we nurture talent. I like this slogan. We have been stuck up somewhere in India by believing the nature of the fate. That was only a mystery. It has been exploded today. We need to nurture. Nature has to be nurtured. It's a big journey to be undertaken. The arduous journey to be undertaken. And that is possible for India. You all know that Lessing, one great philosopher, said that if the God comes before me today, hold the absolute truth in his right hand and the search for truth in the left hand, I will say to the God, you retain the absolute truth, give me the search for truth. This is the real path, because it is a search for truth which gives you the mobility, which will ultimately nurture the talent, which ultimately bring you up for greater heights. I believe on this principle. I think Dr. Ashok Chavan believes in this kind of a, that is how he has set out an agenda. And that agenda is not only the personal agenda for himself. That agenda is very much in consonance with the great journey which India is undertaking to derive the demographic dividend. And it is 200 years back, the US had this kind of an advantage of the youngest country. Another 25 to 30 years, India will have the advantage of a youngest country. If we build the human, manpower, if we build the world-class infrastructure, what US achieved 200 years back, we will achieve it, and I don't think no other country will be matched for India. Rightly, I believe on the principle. After Dr. Ashok Chavan has said, we have one advantage, additional advantage in India, that is, whatever we build on firm ethical foundation. This advantage, I don't think any other people will have. We need to take recourse to this course of action. And today, you are at a very important meeting. And law, medicine and science. I must tell you, law, medicine and science are inextricably linked in ensuring the delivery of justice and maintaining the rule of law in any society. With rapid advances in medicine and scientific knowledge, technology, law and legal science cannot lag behind. Science and technology are proactive, and law, while being reactive, must evolve rapidly enough to keep pace with the development in the world. Medical jurisprudence is the science which teaches the application of every branch of medical knowledge to the purpose of law. All these branches of science are required to enable a court of law to arrive at a proper conclusion on a contested question affecting the life and liberty of individuals. The very word forensic is derived from the Latin word forensic, meaning of the forum. The oldest known law code, the Hammurabi, king of Babylon, during 2900 BC, provides for the rights and duties of a medical practitioner and lays down punishment for physician's negligence. India led the way in forensic science with the first recorded medical legal autopsy being performed in India by Dr. Edward Bulkley as early as 1693. The first medical school was established in Kolkata in 1822 and converted into a medical college in 1835. The first chair of professor of medical jurisprudence was established at Madras Medical College in 1857. The most outstanding contribution by India to the field of legal medicine during the rule of British period is modern dactylographic. Sir William Herschel of the Indian Civil Services first used this method of identification in 1858, and based on this theory, the systematic study and methods of using fingerprints for personal identification was developed in 1892. Medico-legal is the term which incorporates the basics of the two sister professions of medicine and law. Aside from a select few involved in the legal profession, few in common society have more than a vague notion of what it is that constitutes law. Lawyers usually comprehend little about the medical profession and its problems. Physicians frequently know too little about the law and how it affects them in practice of their profession. We need to bridge it. Medico-legal experts can provide a link between these two professions for their smooth and effective functioning in a scientific manner. The physician meets the law at every turn. He confronts it when, as the treating doctor, he is sworn as a witness in a personal injury lawsuit. He meets it when his aid is sought as an expert in connection with a claim that another member of his profession has been negligent, and when he is faced in his office or clinic by a narcotic addict, a man with a gunshot wound, or a young couple seeking a blood test. He is face to face with the law when he is required to render an aggregating array of governmental reports or to preserve physical evidence for the benefit of a law enforcement agency. The physician, in fact, finds a great deal of the law intensely irritating, often because he is not absolutely clear as to its purpose. We are always accustomed to build silos in every science, every social science, every aspect. I think the time has now come to understand each other and proceed further. That alone will benefit the society. Medical jurisprudence is the application of medical science to legal problems. It's typically involved in cases concerning blood relationship, mental illness, injury or death resulting from violence. Vital processes in legal trial involve medical jurisprudence. An autopsy is often used to determine the cause of death, particularly in cases where foul play is suspected. Postmortem examination can determine not only the immediate agent of death, namely gunshot wound, poison, but may also yield important contextual information, such as how long the person has been dead, which can help to trace the killing. Forensic medicine has also become increasingly important in cases involving sexual violence. The establishment of serious mental illness by a licensed psychologist can be used in demonstrating incompetence to stand trial, a technique which may be used in insanity defense, albeit infrequently. Forensic science is an important branch of jurisprudence. Rather, I will say, future language of the jurisprudence is forensic science. We need to address that. All this crude method of investigation or finding truth, you know, will not take us anywhere. We need to transform in a big way in India, and which we are going to do it. As a law minister, I am at it, because I don't want this kind of a torture in investigation or the crude methods by which the truth will not come up, you know, rather, you know, you are planting the falsehood in the criminal investigation system. We need to address them very carefully. In fact, it is a potent and powerful weapon in the administration of justice. The growth, development and use of forensic science in detection of crime in developmental countries are significant. Sciences used in forensics include any discipline that can aid in the collection, preservation and analysis of evidence, such as chemistry for the identification of explosives, engineering for examination of structural design, or biology for DNA identification or matching. A forensic scientist is an expert in any technical field and can provide an analysis of the evidence, witness testimony or examination results, technical support and even training in specialized field. I think it is a dynamic science. We need to, you know, march very carefully, get into these things, because, you know, by depending upon only the old methods will not serve the purpose. Narco analysis, another thing which now the courts are not prepared to accept it. We need to address some of these issues. I think the future science, particularly forensic science, is going to determine the real, you know, the criminal justice system in the country and world over. Expert witness deliver expert evidence about facts from the domain of their expertise. In forensic science, there are forensic experts who have skilled knowledge to analyze evidence and give exact reasoning. Because ultimately, the evidence produced should have certainty and finality. If you don't have the evidence, cogent evidence, which can, you know, speak of certainty and the finality, ultimately judgment will not be very certain, judgment cannot be final, and ultimately it smacks of many, many untruths, which will ultimately do an injustice to everyone is concerned. Science by definition is exact, uniform and variable, and scientific inferences are logically unimpeachable. In the quest to deliver justice, lawyers, investigating agencies and courts of law need the help of scientific evidence and experts in almost every single criminal case. Let there be no conjecture in criminal justice system. DNA was discovered in 1869 by a Swiss scientist, Friedrich Mischer, and it was first used for forensic analysis in England in 1984 in a rape and murder case. The greatest asset of DNA is that it is so specific to every individual that it cannot be tampered. DNA tests can be used to establish parentage of a child, detect crimes, and identify mutilated dead corpses. They are of immense help in criminal justice administration and in some civil disputes like succession, inheritance, etc. DNA testing has become an established part of criminal justice procedure, and the admissibility of the test result in court has become routine. Although DNA testing has accomplished a great deal in opening up new sources of forensic evidence, its full potential to identify perpetrators and exonerate people falsely convicted has yet to be realized. Advances in this field have been made, especially in US, whereas as many as 20 death row prisoners have been proved innocent with the DNA testing playing a role in overturning the conviction. Otherwise, they would have been hanged to death. Remember, this is how miscarriage of justice takes place. Yes, I am conscious of the fact that our Indian Evidence Act, which has become a law about 150 years back, may not be that responsive to the advance of science, particularly medical jurisprudence. I'm contemplating to make a total, you know, restructuring of the Indian Evidence Act so that it can match with the present advancement in the criminal justice system. Forensic science as a scientific discipline, functioning within the parameters of the legal system, not only provides guidance in the criminal and civil investigation, but also supplies the courts accurate information about all the attending features of identification of criminals. Recent advances in modern biological research have revolutionized forensic science, resulting in a radical impact on the administration of justice. In the new scientific era, the emergence of DNA testing changes the role of forensic science in the legal system from passive spectators to the main key player. For example, to determine a child's parentage, this is a statutory presumption under Section 112 of the Evidence Act that any person born during the continuance of a valid marriage between his or her mother and any man or within 280 days after his resolution, the mother remaining unmarried shall be conclusive proof that he is the legitimate child of that man. Unless it can be shown that the parties had no access to each other at any time when that child could have been begotten. Now DNA testing may be used to rebut the said statutory presumption arising under the Act or to establish evidence in the circumstances where no presumption arises. In a recent judgment of the Supreme Court in year 2001, Kanti Devi versus Poshi Ram, the court gave priority to social parentage over biological parentage and thereby rejected DNA evidence by observing that though the result of a genuine DNA test is said to be scientifically accurate, it is not enough to escape from the conclusiveness of Section 112 of the Evidence Act 1872. So we need to work both sides. One, amend the Indian Evidence Act. Another, how to make the result of DNA more positive and will have evidentiary value. This is how we need to address them. In Sharda versus Dharpal, Supreme Court took a very positive view regarding the importance as well as admissibility of DNA evidence in the matrimonial cases. In this case, Supreme Court distinguished the earlier decision in the Gautam Kundu case and further held that in the right to privacy under Article 21 of the Constitution is not an absolute right, and in a case of conflict between the fundamental rights of the two parties, the court has to strike balance between the competing rights. In the light of the new development in forensic science, the Home Ministry constituted a committee under the chairmanship of Dr. Justice V.S. Malimat to suggest reform in the criminal justice system. This committee suggested comprehensive use of forensic science in crime investigation. According to the committee, DNA experts should be included in the list of experts given in Section 293(4) of the CRP. I look forward for your recommendation, and you know, any amendment of Indian Penal Code, Indian Evidence Act is required in the result of the recommendation which you are going to make. After 3 days, I am prepared to accept them and incorporate in the law of the land. There is a unanimity that medical and forensic evidence plays a crucial role in helping the courts of law to arrive at logical conclusions. Therefore, the expert medical professionals should be encouraged to undertake medico-legal work, and simultaneously, the atmosphere in courts should be congenial to the medical witness. I am conscious of the fact, I think our former Chief Justice of India will agree with me, my tribe, that means the lawyer's tribe, may be affected. I think we'll have to take them along with us to make this task very logical and scientific. Need to involve more and more professionals in expert testimony has been felt by different organizations. The American College of Physicians guidelines for the physician expert witness emphasizes on broad physician participation in providing this much needed assistance to the legal system. The college believes that more doctors should serve as experts as a component of their professional activities in order to meet the need for medical testimony. The need of the hour is to have forensic capabilities available to all investigative agencies in order to arrive at the truth. The foundation of our justice delivery mechanism, and sometimes we lose sight of the foundation of our justice delivery system, and truth is somewhere missing and rest of the things come in. I think we need to transform, and you know, there should be, you know, change in our attitude in looking at these things. Local police stations must have dedicated easily accessible mobile forensic units, and local police personnel must be trained to keep crime scenes secure. The sanctity of the rule of law must be maintained and reinforced with the help of forensic science. And modern policing, this is where law, medicine and science must ultimately combine to ensure justice on a timely and fair manner. I think we are also, you know, trying to introduce a lot of scientific methods in the investigation, and to that extent we are also amending the Police Act. And a lot of police reforms and the investigative criminal justice system is on the offing. I'm very happy that, you know, this is, I was told that 1983, the Asia Pacific Conference was held in Singapore, 86 it was held in Colombo, 1989 it was held in Madras, presently Chennai, in India, and 2010 it is again held in India at Noida. I wish the conference a great success. You are at a very, very great, you know, scientific transitional stage. A lot of responsibility is, you know, will rest on you to come out with the state of art, you know, recommendation which all the countries should adopt. India is concerned, I am ready to accept your recommendation. I would like to look forward great deliberation, great recommendation, which will definitely make the march of science into the, you know, justice delivery system. I wish all of you best of time. You know, you have the world's best infrastructure here in Amity University. You are the best experts available here. Then you need to make this conference a great event which will provide great light, you know, beacon light to the scientific, you know, civil and criminal justice system. All the best for inviting me to share some of my experience.